Hey, this is Bruce Trujillo from Indie 1023. My guest today just released their fourth studio album at the beginning of this month, which takes a step forward sonically for the band and puts them in a new space. Chicano Batman is Eduardo Arenas on bass, Carlos Arevalo on guitar, Pardo Martinez on vocals and keys, and Gabriel Villa on percussion. And the new album is called Invisible People. Hey, guys.
Hey, what's happening?
Hi.
Good to see you again.
Good to see you too. Thanks so much for joining me. I know you guys are busy as hell, like talking about this new album. So thank you so much for speaking with me here, and lots to go over. We're going to go step by step throughout this album, kind of song by song. And the big deal that we're experiencing here is it's a new sound for Chicano Batman, a little less retro soul. And if you don't mind, Bardo, you had mentioned it's a little bit poppier, but I think it still has a retro feel to it, maybe different decades and different songs, which is totally cool. Yeah, it makes it fully 2020, and there are still glimmers of like old school Chicano Batman throughout the entire thing. Also, I love how hard you guys are like standing behind this album. You seem super, super proud of it.
Thank you.
All right, so you worked once again with producer Leon Michaels of L. Michaels Affair, and now Sean Everett, who we know who worked with Casey Musgraves and Alabama Shakes. So we'll hear about them a little bit more, but let's get started. Album opener, first single, Color My Life.
Good one.
It is a good one. All right, so new sound, new song. I like that this one starts off the album, and it's really making the statement that this is a new sound for you guys. And it's you're kind of saying like, yeah, we're a Latin band, but that's not it. It's like almost like you're multifaceted people and artists that enjoy many things. Talk a little bit more about like the album opener for this new album.
Well, I guess I'll start. You know, we were working on this album for a while, right? We started summer of 2018, and we definitely had that intention of making it, you know, yes, we're not, we try to make the sound palette so that when you listen to it, you don't necessarily think, oh, this is a Latinx band or whatever. That was one of the intentions. One of the intentions was also, okay, well, like, let's not do the same thing that we did with Freedom Is Free. You know, let's use like polyphonic synthesizers and monophonic synthesizers and lean heavily on keyboards, which is also a different kind of palette, of course. Color My Life was just kind of like one of those things where, you know, we already had a few demos already, had, you know, just throwing in songs. It came from different inspirations. Sometimes Gabo and Eduardo would come up with some tracks, or, you know, I wasn't there for all the sessions. Carlos bought definitely some tracks that the guys put together in our studios. You know, All of My Life, I took a stab at it in my studio, and just, you know, just trying to really, I guess, talking about intentions, just, you know, and back to what I was saying about like pop music, just, you know, listening to whatever, you know, top 40 in 1983 or 1985 or, you know, 79, 78, and just taking from all this like dance music, disco kind of vibe that's like out there, and it has like a very, it has a formula, you know, it has a formula, just like, you know, kick, snare, kick, you know, four to the floor, the bass is on the one, you know, just kind of like, you know, and just kind of really trying to get that feeling, you know, just get that rocking, danceable vibe, and also just kind of make a song that fits within that context and that just really flows and accomplishes the task of really getting, you know, just being an ear grabber, you know, being an ear grabber. So I think that definitely was whoever came up with the instrumentation, whoever came up with like the initial inspiration. I feel like that what tied this record together is that, you know, we really wanted to make people move and dance and groove along with the song.
Yeah, I feel like that you totally make that clear. And that was something that I've read too, is like this album, you really wanted to make like heads bobbing, like people can get into it. Super approachable. Cool. Let's move on to Blank Slate.
Hello, I just want you in my life. And now I'm so excited to feel everything you got inside of your soul now. Everything you got inside of your soul now. I just want to
There's a part of the song that says the past done with, the present is now, which is very fitting here. Blank Slate was the first song written for the album. Also, I heard that you use the original instruments from like Itotiani, but now it's, you know, 2018, 2019 moving forward into this new one. So talk about Blank Slate and like writing this first song for this new album.
Blank Slate, we recorded that in the Studio B of Barefoot Studios, where War's Lowrider was recorded, and probably some Parliament like songs. And it was like we were in this room and it was tight and fat, and it just, when you're in that, and we're so close to each other, and when we're in that atmosphere, it was like, man, like, you know, Marvin Gaye was probably in here, you know, like Stevie Wonder was probably in here with a drum set tracking his drums, you know. We're just like, well, let's live up, let's put our name down here, and let's get our lowrider out of here, you know. And I think for me going in there, I was just like, that was for me the main hype, like, let's make this fat, man, let's get this just sounding like another one of those fat classics, you know, from these artists that we admire and we actually grew up listening to from the radio, not even by choice, like this just comes to you, you know. And for me, it's like that was for me my intention behind Blank Slate, just get this as classic and as fat as possible.
Yeah, I also read that the last song on the album, Wounds, used the piano, like Stevie Wonder's piano on it. That is so amazing. Like, how did it feel being in the studio? Like, oh, this is like legendary stuff happening in here.
It was fun because we had a budget, you know? So it's actually like empowering, because normally when you have a limited budget and resources, you have to work around other people's schedule, right? And studio schedule to get the discount deals. But this time we had a budget and we said, nah, man, these 3 weeks are ours. So we can do whatever the fuck we want, you know? So it was like, everything was fair game. Everything was fair game. There's on Invisible People, there's like, when we were listening back to the tape, when they press stop, it would go like, zoop, you know, like tape does. And then Bardo was just like, yo, let's keep that part. So then they ran the whole thing to tape, they recorded it on there, and they got a sample of that so that we end the, like the choruses or something, we just have the zoop from the tape as an effect. And it's just things like that, that we were just like, if you have an idea and it's good, then it's probably gonna make it on the record right now, because this is our time and our studio space.
It's interesting that you say that, Eduardo, because literally, like, I remember you really having that, like, pushing for that vibe, like, let's just do it now, like, whatever we come up with, like, you know, you were saying that a lot, and I was, like, I definitely resonated with that. I was, like, you just got so many toys there, and it was just, like, it was go time, like, straight up. That was what I was feeling, too, as I was, like, driving from, you know, Northeast LA down to Hollywood, was just, like, yo, we just gotta get it. Like, this is our time to really like capture magic, you know?
That's awesome. And Bardo, you said that you were also inspired by the collaboration you guys did with Miguel on the remix of Black Lipstick. And you guys have been doing a couple of different collaborations over the past few years, like last year's with Caloncho, with Hablame. Also, like, I know in Freedom is Free, you worked with Flor de Toloache. Tell me about like working with other people and how that finds its way into your songwriting, especially on this like newer sound.
I guess with the whole Miguel thing, you know, we had after we finished our collab, which was like, we were his backing band for his song Skywalker, right? And then he sang our song Black Lipstick. So we got to spend a little bit of time with each other, and we even had spoken of maybe doing an album even. And so I was inspired by that, and I went into the studio and just started tracking some some keyboards onto my tape machine along with the little beat machine, you know, just as like the backing track, just to hold it in there as a placeholder for the drums. But then I realized, wow, it'd be cool to actually keep that and have the drums play on top of it. And really, I guess my inspiration, or I was just trying to get like a modern sound, you know, just go to something that sounded new and fresh, something that Miguel would like to sing on, you know. So that was kind of like the initial like impetus for recording that. And I had that in the back burner and I presented it to the guys, and, you know, it went to like 3 or 4 renditions before being completed. But yeah, that's some of that.
That's awesome. All right, so let's get to the third track on here, I Know It. The bass on here I heard was inspired by like Queens of the Stone Age. Eduardo, you mentioned that during your listening party. And at first, not everybody was a fan, but I think it is so fire. My partner and I both play bass, and so we're just like in love with all the bass lines on this album. So tell me more about like bringing these different sounds into the studio. You know, you have your own, you have the bass lines that you're trying to bring in, you have the vocal, like everything, just mixing it in together.
I figured it out last week. And because I've been thinking about what inspired me to play like I played on this record, and it was totally different for me. And I just was like, I remember a few years ago, I was at FYF Festival, and the lineup was the sickest festival I've ever been to in my life. I don't think it'll ever repeat itself because, you know, the past is done with, the present is now. And that's just the past, you know. And I mean, Bad, Bad, Not Good, Erykah Badu, Bjork, Anderson .Paak, Missy Elliott, Frank Ocean. Damn, who else is on that bill?
Solange.
So I remember being there and just like these big massive sound systems, and I just remember the bass coming through in the most fattest way possible. You know, the bass was just so present and clear, and the drums were just fat. And I was just like, man, why don't I just stop envying these people that like play so amazing and this aesthetic, and I just become it, you know? Because I'm obviously gonna bring my own flavor, and Gabo's an awesome drummer that I can mesh with. So I was, instead of being heard, I was like, let's be felt and let's live inside the drums so that the drums and the bass are one thing. And when I went into the studio, like I had my own mission. Like I'm in my own world with bass because, you know, I'm the only one that plays that. There's other harmonic instruments, but the bass is like, honestly, bass playing is like, no one says shit unless you play the wrong thing, you know? Or unless your timing is sucks, so you don't have a good swing. But for me, I went in there and I detuned all my basses down to D flat, all of them, so that when I hit the strings, they would be just wobbly, you know, and just fat. You know, so I had to relearn a lot of my bass lines that same day while I'm tracking to play them like 2 frets up, which I love the pressure. And, you know, it's also like high anxiety. So I did that. And then I also was recording a lot in my studio before that. So I wanted textures. I would play with my finger, like I would grind against the string to get a certain effect. I would put foam mutes on the bottom or on the top of the neck. I would like use a pick, you know, I would go through an amp. I use wah-wah pedals, you know, I would try chorus pedals. I would say like, I was tired of doing the exact same thing for like 10 years. And I said, man, let's take this to the next level. And I guess I personally challenged myself to play simpler and play fatter and just play more like iconic, I guess.
It sounds like that's kind of like the overall theme of this also, just like taking everything to the next level, everybody coming in with like their own flame basically. And also having like the drum and the bass on this one together, I feel like just like fit so well. And there's some like really cool effects that happen throughout the entire album where it's just like, what is this what is this rhythm section happening here? But also you guys allowed yourselves to work separately throughout the writing of this album, which was not necessarily the case on your previous album. So tell me a little bit more about working separately. I know in a couple of spaces, Carlos had to like leave the studio, or like somebody else is working on a different song in a different space.
Tantrums.
So, yeah.
We threw tantrums. Most tantrums I've ever seen from this band in a 1 year period.
This was a labor of love.
Yeah, we tried every, there was no, nothing was off the table on how to compose for this record. So we did try to do like the whole group thing where we're all in the same room, and that yielded some pretty amazing songs. Moment of Joy is one of them that comes to mind. I remember like we set up like the basics of that. Bardo brought that one in and we hammered it out, and he took it home by himself and added the vocals and synth, and it was brought it back, and it was magic. And then there was tunes like Manuel's Story, Wounds, I Know It, what's he want, Prophet. It was me, Gabriel, and Eduardo, like, working on that song. Bardo was, I think he was, like, on vacation or something. And it was just, like, a two-day session, and we cranked all those out. And beforehand, maybe that wouldn't work, or it wouldn't be, it wouldn't, maybe wouldn't, maybe before, like, that was just a process we weren't at all like entertaining. But we showed the songs to Bardo, and we thought they were different and unique, and he was all game for them. He was like, all right, cool. I can just lay some fresh vocals on this and maybe a couple synth lines here, and we have a song, and I'm down. And so that was cool and refreshing for everybody, I think. And yeah, we like I said, we worked on stuff apart, together. It was every mixture everywhere in between, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, it was just like during the whole making of the record, like I said, it was like the summer of 2018. We tried a lot of different things, and some things wouldn't work so well, you know. And so it's just like, you know, and it was really about just trying to tap into some inspiration. So however it happened, you know, sometimes I would just take off. It's like, okay, I'm going to go to the beach and just like chill out and see if a song comes to me, or hang out with my fam, or, you know, whatever. And then, it was great. Like like the guys told me, hey, we're meeting up still, or they're still meeting up. I was like, that's amazing. And then they just came through with some badass joints. And honestly, like I said, I'll just go back to the same thing. It's like, for me, like, it really didn't matter where the inspiration came from. It was just like, we just needed to like, just get that fire. You just got to be dope tracks. And also, to answer your question, like, we all have studios now, which is a big difference than in 2000 and, you know, maybe 15 or 14. And, you know, just had recording setups where we could record and do things separately and have, like, you know, things that just sounded good, and things that we could bounce off of each other.
Tight. All right. Well, let's get to the title track, next one on the album, Invisible People. Older tune, kind of from the Johnny Walker sessions from a couple of years ago, and Leon Michaels slowed it down. And at first it was kind of hard for you guys to get into it. Was that just because it was like, we've been working on this for a couple of years, and you know, why are we slowing it down? Tell me more about like working with Leon on this one.
I just want to say I appreciate you doing your homework. You're coming in fresh as hell. You're like on last week's, you know, information, and that's never happened. So
that's big up to you, Bruce.
I got you.
I'll say something about this one. This one, I remember when we had the demo for this one, I was the one that like reminded everybody that we had this instrumental music already written. And I was really pushing for it. I remember there was kind of not interest, and I took it upon myself to like add a lot of guitar parts that I was really happy with. And Bardo came up with some keyboard parts. And I remember really pushing the band, and everybody was kind of like, oh, that's old. Like, I don't want to work on that. But I was like, no, but it's good. It's good. And we got it to a place where we all pretty much liked it. I think Bardo had to just redo some vocals for the demo version that he wasn't too pleased with. He just wanted to tighten some stuff up. And so we went in thinking like, all right, this is like an up-tempo bopper, like, you just, you know, it was that feel. And Leon was just, like you said, he was like, what if we slow this down and throw in this chord, you know, and play it this tempo? And all, like, my guitar symphony, like, went out the window right there in that statement. And I remember, like, we're about to track in 2 hours, and I was just like, all right, this is what it's about. Like, this is all your idols. They don't, you know, they don't get nervous about this. This is an opportunity to, like, you know, excel. So I think we all just put on our big boy pants and, like, came up with some amazing, unforgettable parts, instrumentally and vocally in that, like, 2 hour time slot before we went and tracked what is the studio version of that. And yeah, I was really proud of all of us. And that was Leon pushing for that.
That's awesome. I love the ending of it where it's just like kind of building up and it just like, kind of like symphonic. I don't know if that's the right word for it, but it kind of explosive a little bit, even though it's like the slowed down track, but it's like super impactful. Bardo, you actually mentioned that you're excited to play this one live. I think it's kind of like anthemic. And also mentioning like the big lie that everybody lives in, it's even in the song, the concept of race was planted in your brain. I feel like this one like specifically touches like the core of Chicano Batman, like the ideas that you guys have been pushing for like the past 10 years. Tell me more about writing the lyrics for Invisible People.
Yeah, I actually didn't, you know, record any vocals at the session. You know, it was just a matter of like, you were just chopping up the track and just making sure the track was dope. And I had some like sketches for vocals that I had for a while, right? Like Carlos was saying. And when I went into the studio, maybe like a few weeks after we had tracked it, I went to New York for like 10 days. And I just really, you know, I sat down with Leon on it. You know, we were just going through what I had. And, you know, I just kind of ditched a lot of the old stuff, you know, because with this, I just wanted to have some punchlines, you know, just say things that just really got to the point really fast. You know, that just like went to the heart of whatever I was trying to communicate. And Leon definitely was like my mirror for that. As I was writing and going through vocals, he was just like, that one doesn't work. Oh, that's weird. Oh, that doesn't make sense. You know what I mean? But I think we got to something really cool. And I like it a lot because it just, like I said, it's something that was new for me. I think like maybe an older past, I guess my older process was to just be more wordy or more elusive in terms of what I'm saying. I don't know. I was just trying to create something where it's just like anybody could understand it, you know, mm-hmm. just, you know, you just like smoke, you know, light a spliff so I can heal now, you know, just like, exactly. Yeah.
All right. Let's get to Emmanuel's story. This is the next album on Invisible People.
The other day my uncle told me a story. He said, son, it gets up to glory. One night I had to flee and leave my land. My older brother stole some heavy contraband. The gift for him he wasn't there, they came for me.
We were tracking the song, and then I had this idea in my head. I was like, I'm gonna try this idea. And like, I know I'm going to get shit for it, you know, and I'm just going to put my head down. So we start playing 1, 2, 3, 4, boom, boom. You know, the song started and I dropped out and I'm just like, I'm just not going to play, you know? And then someone, maybe Gabo always notices when I'm fucking up, you know? But like, I was just like, just put my head down. I'm like, I'm just going to ride this shit out. Let's see how far I can go before I have to play a note. You know, So that was my little trick for that. And I think I go up like a minute and 12 seconds or something before my bass line comes in. And I was just thinking like, for me, I have this idea. It's just like, not everyone has to be in for the song to be like the song, you know? And I like to build things theatrically like that. So I felt like whenever like my bass came in, I think it was like at the chorus, first chorus or something, you know, it was just one experiment that I tried. That ended up working out, just like waiting a minute before my bass line came in. Never tried that before. I never had the guts to do anything like that.
It really makes a big impact. Like it drops on the second verse. So it's like, you know, like it just works in terms of the song. Like, you know, I sing the first verse and it's just like floating with the drums, right? And then invisible people, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
That's what the bass drops. So anyways.
Can we talk about those drums, Gabriel? Like,
can we talk about those drums?
How did you come up with that part? Because it's so good. Like that first, like Eduardo said, because the focus is off the bass coming in at the top. It's just you with that. What happened? How did you come up with that?
That was like my intention of creating space by just being very simplistic. Since like we changed the whole deal on that song. You remember the version we had, it was super fast, up speed tempo. When we got to the studio, like you said, Carlos, it was just like, no, we're gonna slow it down, you know, you just change this. So the whole thing flipped, you know, and that was the moment to do like, okay, let's improvise, let's create with the environment, let's listen to whoever it's giving input. And I remember Leon told me, no, just go simple, you know. And so I was just, all right, I imagine everything else that is happening right now. So I just play kick and snare, and I imagine the whole rest in my head. But that sensation, that feel, it's creating like a deep hole. And Eduardo, by not playing, the moment he drops, that's what it creates, that this whole like super big sound, you know, and that feel, you know, because it's really like you said, Bruce, it's really dramatic. It's creating drama in the music itself, and that space is like swallow and then hits, like that's the effect. So that was my approach, you know.
Tension,
I feel like there's a lot of that space within the album too, and like these like hard stops that you come to on these drums, it makes such a cool effect on, like with the lyrics and how it plays with the bass line, and even like with the guitar solos and stuff, you can just hear it in the back, just all of a sudden it's like kind of just like ends and then drops into the next one. It's just like it does add to that drama. Like, was this something that you were like trying to do after you guys had written all of these, or was it something that you had been working on anyway?
Many of the things happened on the studio. We were playing at this amazing spot. It was just like a playground. It was amazing. Since the moment we visit the studio, just to think about, are we gonna do this here? I felt everyone's like being so positive about it. It's like, this is the vibe. This is the place. This is the studio where, you know, like Stevie Wonder track. And I was like, what? Really? Oh, and we went with all guns into the studio. You know, I brought my drum set, my beautiful, like, super vintage. But guess what? They told me, but we had toys here. We had really good, like, equipment. We have, like, they even designed, like, preamps over there. They have, like, so that helped, like, create, like, deep sounds, and at the same time, change the game, our game, to inspire, like, creating something new and fresh.
I remember there was so much drama. A little fun fact. There's so much drama attached to a lot of these demos because we had them for like 8 months. Imagine having like a song for 8 months and then like 4 months in there, I want to change this up. Or I'm not really feeling this anymore because you've already reinvented yourself. And so you're everyone's fighting for their own arrangements. At some point, we had stalemates. Like it would not, we cannot move forward. So then we would be like, well, forget it then. We'll just let Leon decide. Like if he was a referee, tiebreaker. We need a tiebreaker. It's four of us, you know. So we had a big old list, man, of like things we needed Leon to break the tie on, you know. So when we went to the studio, we knew what these things were. We're not gonna act stupid. We knew what these things were. So as soon as we're trying to play them, and Leon's like, "Yeah, don't play that. Yeah, we don't need that." Or like, "Yeah, just tell it simpler." Like, I remember me like putting my head down. I'm like, I'm gonna go get a coffee right now. I'm like, this is great. I love this. Everyone's on their toes now because you had to get rid of your love affair for your line, because there's someone here that's gonna like get the best of you for the song. Someone's working for the songs, not for you as an instrumentalist.
Right, and like a fresh pair of ears too. Like you guys have been sitting with these for a couple of months, and then you bring them to somebody else. It's easier to move forward with somebody that's maybe not as attached. The story on this one is so good, just like in general. It doesn't matter if it's like a tall tale or if it's a real story, like the storytelling in and of itself is just so good. And it's the backbone of it. And just one of the many reasons that we have like migration through the Americas right now. And sonically, like the synths on this one, it's just like so driving. And, you know, if you took away the vocals on it, it would just be like still like one of those like boppers. So tell me a little bit more about Manuel's story.
Yeah, I mean, it was one of those, it was a track that Carlos had brought to the table, and that it's one of those tracks that the band had recorded, and without me, I wasn't there, and I heard it, and I was like, damn, this is fucking amazing. This is dope. And I'm talking from the demo stages, right? And so I took the demo. I didn't really know what to do with it. I think we even recorded it. We recorded it. I had no, I think I already had an idea. I'm trying to remember when I recorded vocals on it.
I remember, we had it done, man. Go ahead, Carlos.
I remember me and Bardo ran into each other at the Voids show at the Wiltern, and he came up to me, and he was like, "Hey, I finally wrote vocals to Manuel's story."
Yeah.
He was like, "Let me tell you about this. It's basically like a narco corrido, like in English." And I remember you were so excited about it. Yeah, I'll let you tell the rest.
Yeah, that's exactly. Yeah, you're right. It was in the demo stages that I had come up with the lyrics. I went to Colombia. And I was there for like 2 weeks, and I spent another week in Panama. My uncle lives in Colón, and so we spent some time on an island just hanging out, chilling. And after like taking a boat ride around the island, we just started talking along with the you know, our little ferry of the ferry guy who rode the boat, who drove us around. He's a super cool guy. He was actually really cool man from, like, he was actually Salvadoran, I think he was born in Panama, but his parents were from El Salvador, and super humble cat and knowledgeable. And they were just talking about drug cartels and just like, you know, how real it is right there in that, you know, off that, the coast of Panama right there, so close to the Caribbean, so close to Florida. It's just like the drug trade has always been real there. And so my uncle started telling me about the story of how he got there, you know, and it's a true story. Like, literally, he just told me the story the way I'm telling it to you, the way I tell it to everybody, the way I wrote it down. I just try to capture the essence of it. I just try to make it pop. But because, you know, I feel like people from the Caribbean are also very like natural storytellers. Like, they're just amazing at telling their stories, like with such an amazing flow and rhythm and vibe that. When I heard the story, it was like my jaw was just like, it was just like a Pulp Fiction. It was like Pulp Fiction, like right in front of me. Like, it was just so cinematic. So I knew I had to use that some way. And so yeah, I had that track, and then I just went to it, and you know, that was the result. I'll also say that, talking about the Voids, like, I've been into the Voids for a while now. So it's like, you know, that track had such a rock and roll vibe to it. You know what I mean? I feel like I don't know. So I took that vocal approach as well. Kind of like, you know, just to me, it's just like that draw, that kind of like Julian style. You know what I mean? People might not hear it, but that was my influence on the track.
That's awesome. And I love the instrumentation on this too. I feel like it's really driving, which also moves that story forward. The bass line that did it, that like everything is kind of has this forward momentum for it. So it adds this sense of urgency. Had you guys heard this story before you had written like any part of the music for it?
No, I just did what Carlos told me to do.
Yeah. We showed up to a session with me, Gabriel, and Eduardo, and I had this song idea in mind. And it revolved around this krautrock rhythm. It's called the Motorik beat, and that's spelled Motorik. And it's basically like the universal, like, prog krautrock beat. Like, it's like a trance. And Stereolab used it a lot. They were influenced by, like, Can and Noi, bands like that, that employed that rhythm. And I was like, what if Chicano Batman did a song based off that rhythm? And so I had the rhythm in mind. I told Gabriel, I played him like a Can record. I was like, can you do a beat kind of like this, but your own take? He came up with his drum beat, and then I was able to layer like my guitar part, and I, you know, guided Eduardo. I mean, he came up with all his stuff independently, but, you know, I was like, this is the vibe though. And yeah, that was the feel. It was just like this driving beat, like hypnotic, and you're bouncing to it quick. It's kind of, you know, and I thought it was going to be a for fun session. Like, this is just us making music for fun. There's a lot of times where we make songs and people don't ever hear them. And I thought maybe this is probably going to be that. But Bardo took it, and the story fit the vibe of the instrumental very perfectly. And yeah, it was meant to be.
Yeah,
I remember we recorded the song in my studio, and then we were just having a good time sonically. And I was like, I think I had to leave and shit. We all had to leave. Or Carlos had to leave. And I was like, dude, let's just bounce this on two track, like quarter inch right now, you know, and then bounce it right back. So I even bounced that on an Atari two track, and then I bounced it back, and I just was trying to like get this to sound just amazing, fast. Like it was one of those things on the whim. And then I remember we were at rehearsal. I think Bardo had come in with the vocals. We were playing the song, and he sang it, or he played the demo, like his demo. And I just remember going up to Bardo and just like giving him like the hand, like, Bardo, that is a song, bro. Like, wow, like that's a song. And it's just moments like that where it's great to lend your trust to each other, because fools will come through in a big, big way. And Bardo came in like he wrapped it up, like done, you know. It was great.
Yeah, it was just such a dope track, man. Like when I now that I hear everybody talking about it, you know, I just remember just like that guitar riff was just like so heavy. Like even when we got the master, the mix back, I was like, damn, the guitar's not loud enough. Like, we need more guitar. Because it was just so driving and like rock and roll, and like, you know, we're just trying to like capture that spirit. And I think we really did with that joint.
Every time I there's space for me, I always try to go funk with it, you know? And for me, I was like, well, this could work still, you know? I like to do a lot of chromatics, very, very simple. Boom, 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 you know? Mm-hmm. Or just like, you know, pentatonics if I can get away with it, you know? But at the very end, like the icing on the cake was, Carlos got in a multivox, like analog synth, and he put the dung, ding, dong. And I swear to God, that was like, that was the glue for the whole thing. I think we were done with the song, and I was like, Carlos, you need something, man. Like, get on, you know, like do something, like do something like to catch it. And you kind of just came up with it real quick. Dun, dun, dun. Like, you know, that's all you need sometimes.
Yo, and we kept that. We kept that all the way to the end. So we went into the studio, try to track and try to get the same sound in the studio barefoot, but we didn't capture it. And so we end up going into like the old files of the demos, pulling that original sound that he's describing. And the sound that you're hearing on the record is that sound.
Yeah, it was too good. And then Sean Everett just tweaked it the hell out and gave it so much space and wash, you know, made it huge.
Yeah, it's got this like great 80s synth vibe, like that particular.
Totally.
Dun, dun, dun. It's like, oh, this is like.
It's a multi-box.
That's why I like having that. That's a good piece to point to as far as like having a new sound that's like you can point to any decade within the last like 5 decades on this album, and it's like that's like the 80s vibe right there.
Totally.
So, like that one. So let's move on to Moment of Joy. I love the vibe on this one, but I know it was a labor of love. You said that you had to like kind of track super low on it. So tell me more about recording this one, just kind of being light with all of your instruments to get this one where it is.
It was, usually when we record a song in the studio and we're in studio mode and this is making an album time, we track it 3 times and we're done. We're on to the next song. So we track this at the beginning and we all, I think, kind of had an inkling like, we didn't capture it. And I remember Leon approached us like the day, second to last day before studio time was up. And he was like, I think we got to retrack Moment of Joy. And I remember just being like, oh man, like, oh. but he was right. Yeah. I'll let you guys take it from there. But I just wanted to throw that in. I remember just being like, okay, this is new. We've never had to redo a song. Hmm. And but it was the right call.
Yeah, you know, for me, like, I was just thinking about it, you know, in terms of, like, recording in the studio, all I played was, like, the roads on a bunch of tracks. Like, I literally just played, like, just the chords. And, like, my job in the studio was mostly, like, just to make sure that the song, like, whatever the track was, is, like, as succinct and as strong as possible. Like, I didn't really play that many instruments. And so, like, it was just a matter of, like, just Leon making the call. Like, we had the arrangement. We spent a lot of time arranging songs, like, straight up. Like, and the same thing with Moment of Joy. We were just, like, going in there with the scissor, with the, you know, with the samurai sword, just chopping it up and making sure that everything was going to be as strong as possible at the end. Like, at the end result, like, this is going to be, like, a really good song. And so once that was done, it was just a matter of tracking it. And bass and drums was the most important thing, straight up. So yeah, second call, Leon was like, we got to do it over. It was just on Gabriel and Eduardo, really, to just to get the feel, or everybody. But I guess, just the drums and the bass had to be right.
That's one of the things about being in the studio. It's like, we all perform it live, but if Gabo and I don't create magic together, we're not keeping it. That's you know, you can always move a guitar track or retrack it or something, but drums and bass. And there's only like, God, what would you say? There's only like, maybe we'll track something 9 times and there's only one that really is the one, you know? Yeah. There's only one. Like, it's not like maybe these four are good. No, there's only one. And like, we always have these we call them once in a lifetime moments where we do these accidents that we keep. Or we'll be tracking, I look at Gabo, I'll be like, Gabo. And he's just like, I don't know what's going on, you know? And then we keep it because it's just so funky and unique. I remember for this track particularly, there were so much, the synths were just so big. Wah, wah, and then the synth lines were just really catchy. And I was thinking like, I don't got to do nothing. You know, like it's the song's kind of carrying itself with a kick. And that's what made me just come up with that line, like the doop, boop, 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 boop. You know, I was like, I'm going to try something different. Like, I don't want to have to ride the song. Like, I want to ride on top of the song, you know, just like everyone else with a riff, you know, and let's see if I can get away with it, you know. I basically try to do things to see if I can get away with it. And if nobody looked my way and concerned it, I was like, I think I'm doing all right.
That's great. I remember for that one, we play on the studio. We were on studio A on the umbrella for the final track. Because we tracked it on studio B, right? And then it didn't work the first time. And then we went to the change things up. And then like, I was just convinced, like, all right, what should I do, like, different? Why it didn't work? And I was just like, I remember just Leon telling me, like, just play softer. And I was barely playing. I remember I was barely playing. And I was under the umbrella, the drum umbrella that they have over there. It was almost on my head. I was just like, how less can I play? Like, can you guys hear me out there on the control room? And they were just, it's perfect. Keep it up, you know? And I was just like, really? What's going on? Can you hear me, Eduardo? Like, and it worked. You know, sometimes less is more. It creates that whole, like Eduardo says, sometimes it's like the West Coast, like, sound that we're getting, you know, into that song. So it's great.
She's the pink elephant in the room. Mercenary with perfume, just like in the movies, she kills for fun, decapitating heads like the shogun.
The drumbrella is something in Studio A, I think, that Barefoot copied from Ocean Way Studios. And what it is, it's this freaking umbrella that hangs over the drum set. So there's like this machine. You go, and then it brings the drumbrella down over the drum set. And while it's doing that, it's not only pitching it, but it's also deadening it. So right. If you bring it up, it just makes a wider drum, and you bring it down. I remember the fucking drum, the drumbrella was like on gobble, like right here. And he had to play really low. I see him in a super pissy mood. Like, what the hell are they expecting me to do?
Should I even play? Like,
I remember looking at him like, I can't even make eye contact with Gabo right now. He's not like, I don't know what's happening anymore. But then, see, it's like, you can be doing ridiculous stuff out in the studio, but then you go in the control room, you're like, oh, yeah, amazing, you know?
It makes sense.
I wanted to say, when we tracked Moment of Joy, just to finish up on that aspect of it, it's like, you know who does that? And just talking to the band is Conan Moccasin. Like, he records very, very quiet, and but just turns like the signal up really, really hot. And you get that vibe. It's weird. And I feel like there's like a kind of a kindred spirit on that vibe in that regard. Like, I remember when we played, like, you had to just like be relaxed. And it was like you were at the library and you're talking like this. And I remember just being like leaning back on my chair, just playing as soft as I could in the pocket, like literally like this, like dun, 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 dun. And I remember looking at Eduardo and Gabriel, because we were in the same vicinity and same vibe, just like, it was crazy.
Which also, like, now that you're mentioning it, I just, knowing your guys' live shows and how you play, and like, specifically Eduardo, watching you play bass, like, it's very like, you're into it, like, I can't imagine having to like scale back and try and be as quiet as possible. Like, just, it doesn't seem like intuitive for you guys specifically.
Well, it's because I can see myself performing it on stage, and I can see, like, it goes back to the sound system. It's like, if I play this like this, like, I know I'm going to give myself space to really rock it in a really open arena or in an amphitheater. Like, I know I'm going to give myself, like, it'll bump in the car, you know, and you'll hear my notes, as opposed to if I play double the notes and you'll just hear a rumble, you know, you'll hear it. You know, when you get enough studio, you know, experience, I think, you know what's going to look like on the other end.
Definitely. All right. Well, speaking of these bass lines, let's move on to Pink Elephant, actually, because the bass line on this one is so sick. So tell me about writing Pink Elephant and making this one like slap.
So in the same way that Carlos was like, let me what's that Cronkite beat, what's it called, the Cronker,
King Kong,
the King Kong beat,
motor beat,
the motor croc, the motor croc,
croc,
the crock of shit beat. So
we are croc rock. Gabriel Louis rocking the dope crocs.
So in the same way that Carlos was like, let's get this croc going, I was just like, let's be a hip-hop band. Like, let's get this as fat as possible. You know, Gabo and I have always had sessions going back to 2008, 2009. You know, we would be at my bedroom, actually, because we would rehearse, and then it would be like 2 a.m. and he'd still be there. You know, and we'd be just partying, basically. Every rehearsal was like a party. And then I'd be like, dude, come here, man. You have to listen to this. And I would put like Brown Sugar by D'Angelo. And I know God hadn't heard this stuff before. And I would put like Sly Stone. I would put like all the stuff. And like, dude, you have to listen to, you have to tap into this, because this is where the magic's at. Look what they're doing. So that's been our relationship for many years. Just like getting Gabo hip to a lot of the stuff that I knew was like Rafael Sadiq and stuff like that. That was just really cracking. And you know, he put it in his library and he messed with it, which is great. And so for Pink Elephant, I had, my brother gave me a gift certificate for a car wash. It was like a $40 car wash at a car wash in Montebello. And so I was like, all right, that's cool. And so then one day I was like, yeah, okay, I feel good. I'm going to go get my $40 car wash. And then they cleaned it. They put a freshener in there. I threw that shit out because, you know, it's bad for your, it's carcinogenic. And so then, but I was like, damn, this car is clean. And then I just, you know, I bumped my stereo and I'm like, I think I had Cypress Hill or something. I'm like, man, I'm a G right now. This is what it feels like. $40 car wash. Huh? Okay. So then that was my idea going into the song. I was like, this demo is called $40 car wash. I want to bump this as dope as I feel right now. My little red 2003 Civic, you know,
with my, like, you know, my my car system. And so that was kind of the idea for that. Let's just get a Dilla style. Let's go Jay Dilla on this, you know. And Gabo came in totally with the right mindset, and we just took it from there.
Love it.
Yeah, it was like originally it was like a 5-minute opus. It had like 3 or 4 different sections, but I remember like listening to it, and it was like there was this one section, boom boom ba 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 boom boom boom, and I was like, this is money. I don't know about all the other stuff, but this is money. And we just started working with it in the studio, like at rehearsal, and that's how we started to craft it.
I feel like this is also one of those ones with the drums where it's like, it's got those stops in it. It was like kind of, and it like, I think it just accentuates like everything else so good. And like the guitar line, and this is like my favorite song on the album, like 100%.
Oh, cool.
I love that
one. Oh yeah.
And we put that out as a single, like our second single, knowing that what kind of album we had in the bag. And I think we were just trying to be provocative. Just mm-hmm. be like, well, we released Color My Life. Like, they obviously, the public has had a great response to it. Let's put out Pink Elephant, you know? I think that the record label, I mean, our label said, let's put out Pink Elephant. And we were like, I was happy about it because I was like, oh, man, curveball. Here come the haters, here come the lovers. They have no idea that we have, like, songs like Wounds and Invisible People and Manuel's Story. And, like, every song is so different. Mm-hmm. They're just going to go and judge. And, like dead leaves on a branch, like, you know, let them fall, man, because if you don't believe, then, you know, you're not ready for what's coming. So it was kind of like, it was a cool way to just brace people and see who's down and who's not. At the end, everyone's been down, even the haters. So it's like awesome.
You can't escape it. This one also, I know that you guys play solo shows, Bardo, you do stuff, and then Eduardo, you have Iarenas, who's like your shirt right now. Do you find that your solo stuff kind of seeps into Chicano Batman, or is it easy to separate like the stuff that you're doing on your own? You can walk into a CB practice and know that it's Chicano Batman.
I'll say that, like, I feel like everything that we've done, like, for me, I speak for myself, it just comes in. Like, it just comes into the music. Like, it's just practice, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, for me as a songwriter, I can only bring so much to Chicano Batman, right? You know, and especially because there's 3 other songwriters in the band, right? So it's just like, so I have to express it somewhere. So I've been recording a lot, and thankfully I have, you know, the setup now. Big ups to Eduardo, he helped me out with that as well. And just been recording like nonstop, like since 2016, you know? And so I have like tons of demos and tons of stuff. So it was just one of those things where it just makes you better, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think for me, I can't separate it. You know, when I come to the guys and we make music together or whatever I bring, it's hand in hand. Like, you know, I'm the same person. And I think it only brings more wealth to what we're doing as a whole.
For sure.
Me, I save the best stuff for my own solo project. So in case I make like $1 million, like I don't have to share the money. And that's always been always been my idea, you know. I'm the star, and you know. So yeah.
No. Eduardo's the star.
For my solo stuff, I feel like I'm like a sprinter running a 400-meter. Okay. And Chicano Batman, I'm playing defensive tackle in a different sport.
You know? Gotcha, yeah.
So it's like, it's 2 different things, you know? And also in Chicano Batman, I have Bardo and Carlos, who are fucking amazing musicians, you know, who also play guitar and keyboards and have melodic, like, leanings and harmonic visions and stuff like that. Like that is the majority of the band. Like, I like to hear them come up with ideas, because I'm good at arranging and stuff like that also, but I would much rather see what they bring to the table and then help with that, you know, improve that than to, like, you know, bring in compositions, because their voices are, I mean, their voices are, we're still developing our voices, you know, and the process has been great, and their growth has been amazing. And, you know, I kind of just like riding the back seat and just laying it down fat for them to be confident that what they're doing is dope. You know, that's, I think that's the difference between both projects.
Yeah, I feel like with yours specifically, like I got to see both Y Arenas and Chicano Batman at Tropicalia in November. And it was like, you know, they're like, it is a totally different vibe, which is really cool. But going back to what Bardo was saying, like bringing it in, like having that experience with your own music and then bringing it in, I think just makes the Chicano Batman tapestry a little bit richer, you know, everything that you guys do on top of it.
And you know what, at the end of the day, what's great is that anything that we do with the band, outside the band, it all comes back to the band, mm-hmm. you know? It's all the identity of the band because we're still members in it. Like Bardo was saying, we're still the same person. Yeah. You know, so we all reap the benefits of the stuff that we're doing in and out of this group because we're providing like an aesthetic, like the culture. We're developing the culture around this, around our generation, you know, and around our people and our musical community. So it's like, it's all in one at the end of the day.
Yes. All right, let's move on to polymetronomic harmony. Each part of this song is so interesting on its own. The guitar intro, I think, is just beautiful. And then the synths come in. The beat, again, like the drums on here, what is happening is so good. And it just makes it really apparent that each piece of the puzzle here is has really come together and it's really strong. And, you know, it works together harmoniously, I feel like, on this one, because you could take each piece of the song and write a completely different thing, but it comes together here. So how did this one come into being, polymetronomic harmony?
It was pretty much a demo that I put together. I was just literally like sick at home. I had a stomach flu and I was just like, had nothing to do but watch TV. So I was just watching like some obscure, like late 60s French film or something like that. And, it just kind of, I love like 60s music as a whole. Like I love like the late 1960s as like a, like musically, and you know, all I like, it's a very imaginative, very creative period in music, in popular music. And so I don't know, I've always tried to like include that somehow within the stuff that I work on. Sometimes I don't get to, or sometimes it doesn't fit, but I felt like basically composing that. All I'm trying to say is like I felt the spirit of that, and I wrote a song that tried to encapsulate what that meant to me at the moment. But it turned out to be something that was very gritty, and it's like the whole song is really just one phrase repeating itself, you know, and then mm-hmm. just the music changes, and it's almost like I wanted to create something with that vibe, but then something that's gonna make people just like mosh, you know, something that's gonna get the people just like the beat is driving. You know what I'm saying? And I don't know, also very like open. And originally there was like a big chorus that was repeating throughout the whole time, like towards the end. It ended up getting all cut. But anyways, yeah, that was some of the inspiration behind it.
When Bardo brought that song, I think he did a great job of capturing that vibe of like that 60s European film kind of style in the sound of it. Like it reminds me of that. It reminds me of like Stereolab. Like they did that a lot. Like they were referencing that kind of cinema, and you hear it in like their 60s via 90s interpretation of that sound. And I felt that for this song. So when Bardo brought over the demo to my house, I just added like a little keyboard line that's in like the breakdown. It's like a my Prophet keyboard. And I felt like I was just thinking in terms of like, what would Stereolab do right here? And then he gave me space for like a solo at the end. And I had been listening to a lot of Zamrock, which is like garage rock music from Zambia in like the 70s. And they have like these very, very raw recordings with like fuzz guitar solos. Specifically, there's this group called Ngozi Family, which I encourage everybody to go check out. I was just trying to get that kind of a sound on the guitar. And I don't know, for some reason, those stylistic, they're very different, but it married together pretty cool, like on the track.
Tight. Well, speaking of this like kind of 60s vibe, let's move on to The Way, which is the next song on the album. I have a hard time when people say, oh, this sounds like the Beatles, but there's like a part in the song where I'm like, this sounds like the Beatles, which is like, they're my favorite band. So I'm like, all right, this is pretty fucking cool.
I can't stop reflecting upon the reflection of my own reflection. It's like a mind game that I can't tame. Like an empty shell that feels no pain. Just like the body is twitching, convulsing in every direction. We are a fragmented shard of glass, with minds fixated on the past. How do we heal, Mama?
I had remembered something, like you had said that you had a new album coming out, and I thought I remembered the lyrics from it, but apparently not. Either way, the song has like so much to it, which I love. There's like all of the changes, a bunch of different sounds. We've got like the flute, which is so great. Like I love all of the stuff on this one. So you know, like, and the big finish too. It sounds like, you know, the wedding bells at the end. So tell me about tracking this one and bringing in all of these different sounds and changes into this one song.
Yeah, I mean, it was one of the, it was like the old, how can I put it? I had composed it on my acoustic guitar, had brought it to the band. We had tracked it. It was kind of like a difficult thing to track because it was, or to put together because of the different times, tempo changes within the track. Like, okay, it starts off at 123 and dips down to 120 and goes back up to 123. And then the chorus is at 110 or something. It's not that, but it just gives an example of how difficult it was. And then, it, which was kind of similar to maybe some of our older Chicano Batman music with a lot of changes, right? Tempo changes and whatnot. And it was also very similar. So anyways, with this record, we're trying to go with the, since our approach was more new and fresh and like maybe more simple, I don't know. It was also something that I think it didn't really have much room for. It was already something that had like a really clear vision. So Carlos was pretty opposed to it at the beginning. You know, there was not a lot of room to like create, because it like it was basically like four vocals. Like the track, the music had to fit like the tempo of where the vocals were taking it, because that was the intention of it. Now, so it was almost like something on the back burner, you know. But like our producer really liked that song. He was like, "Oh, we gotta record the way," and it was just like, it was towards, I don't know, a really busy day. We had already tracked a bunch of tracks and everybody was tired. And I think Leon was like, Leon is really one of those guys, like, you know, he's not there to hold anybody's hand. He's just there to get the job done. So it was just like, you know, hey, let's do the way. And it's like, maybe it wasn't very like popular or whatever, but it was like, we just had to do it.
And I loved it.
And,
It's not that I didn't like the song, Bruce. It's that Bardo told me, you don't need to play anything on this song. And so I was like, okay, I'm not going to root for this song then if I'm not going to play anything on it. That's what it was.
Hey, Carlos, this song doesn't need you on it, man. Go take a break.
I did not say that.
In general. But it's one of my favorites. After, I mean, we did record it and Leon brought it, we tracked it. Bardo went on a lunch break and Leon was like, get in there and start recording some guitars. So I went in, recorded my guitars, and with Leon's guidance, because I didn't know how to approach it. I was already like exhausted from the whole process of trying to approach that song. And but Leon guided the way. He was like, play something like this sound or this kind of vibe. And he was right, it worked. I don't know, I loved it. And I feel like altogether, the finished product was like, it exceeded my expectations. And
was this the one you walked out on as well?
Yeah, because I wasn't needed for the tracking of it. Yeah, literally, there was nothing.
We were like, where the fuck is Carlos? Like, did he leave? What? He left. I was so mad, and I was like, I was laughing and mad. I was like, wait, I don't know what to feel either.
Now do you need a glass? It all seems like a fable, yeah. Whatever you feel, I feel.
So tell me about also like The Prophet, moving into recording that one as well.
Well, first on the way, on the chorus, you know, when like
does it feel, or what is this, mama, you know, mm-hmm. for that, my bass line, I had always thought of like, you know, the, I want to do it to you, you know, it goes boom, 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 I want to do it to you, you know that song?
Yeah.
That was my bass line right there. I was like, I'm going to go with this, you know, I'm going to just like open it though. Boom, 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 boom. Anyway, so so for Polly, there's a little secret there. For Polly,
a little secret.
You know why I didn't like the Prophet? Because it was a synth. It was one of the first songs where Carlos was like, wah, wah, big old like blanket. And I was just like, what is this? You know, I felt like an old guy. You know what I'm saying? That like, oh, what's with this rebel music? The frequencies. No, 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 no. And then yes, 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 was, you know, the solution. So it was just like, how do I get in the track and not judge myself for how I'm sounding that I otherwise would not play, you know? Mm. But it sounds good in the song. But I did like, the only part of the thing that I did like was in the beginning was the chorus. Like, because I had this like groovy walking bass line on the top, you know, and that's some stuff that I picked up like from Solange, just how to bounce around and not really like, you know, play root notes or something, you know.
This was one, Bardo, that you had to keep changing the lyrics, or like in your listening party, you said like we had to keep changing the lyrics. Bardo would come back and it'd be a completely different song, so Carlos left and like just trying to get the final version, but. It seems like such a profit for profit, like how hasn't this been done before? But it's like, you know, I feel like it's a pretty deeper song than that even. Bardo, how did you come up with the final iteration of these lyrics that you were finally satisfied with?
Yeah, it was just kind of like a tapestry, you know, because it was like, I had this idea. So first of all, the track was actually called, was titled after the keyboard that we used on it, like the Prophet, like a Prophet, like the polyphonic synthesizer that Carlos had. So that was our working title for the song. And so when I first grabbed the track that the guys had recorded, I put it on my Pro Tools, started recording to it like I do, and just kind of playing around. And I was like, oh, this is the Prophet for Profit. Wow, that's an interesting concept, right? Just kind of like playing on that irony, which is kind of like so real, right? You know, like, it, you know, as musicians, you want to, I mean, how can I put it? Like, you know, you reflect on everything that's going on around you. You talk about, you know, injustice. We talk, you know, in the past, we've done that as a band, but that it's also like, I wanted to kind of ride this wave. It's like, okay, well, we're creating new music and this is like fresh and pop. And so it's just like, how could I put it? Like, you know, it's very easy for somebody to call you a sellout or whatever, you know, like we've you know, we do the Johnny Walker thing, whatever. But it's just like, yo, everybody out there, you're living in a city, you're pumping gas in your car. There's so many like instances of hypocrisy in everybody's daily life. You know, if they want to be a quote unquote good person, you know, what does that look like? You know? And so it's just kind of like, just playing with all of that, really, you know, just like I started off writing like the verse, like, it doesn't bother me, just leave it on the table. Now, do you need a glass? You know, it's all a big fable, you know? So I don't know. I'm just playing with a lot of social elements and working with wordplay and also just owning the fact that like, yo, this is just my moment in time. Like, I'm in a band. And my job is to play music and to make music. Like, yo, that's it. I'm just an artist, like, trying to be me up in this thing.
Yeah, we had a couple of discussions over this one. Like, what is the profit for profit? And we were like, oh, banking, or even like water rights, or like oil and gas. So I feel like it can like fit into a bunch of things that are extremely relevant and right in your face right now. So I think it's like, you know, it's open enough to where it can be about a bunch of different things, but like, it's very timely as well. All right, let's go on to Bella.
Mm-hmm. dancing in the morning. I feel much better now that you are here.
I just think this one feels so good. I think it's so sweet, like something you could sing to your like little baby. This one was also though super last minute. You guys kind of wrote it in the studio.
Pretty much.
Yeah, this one almost didn't make it. At the end of the day, we were thinking about cutting Prophet and Bella. I don't know why. I forgot all of it. It was just like, and Bella was just like, we just didn't think it was like strong enough or something. It was just a simple song that had so much reward, you know?
Gabriel, you had like a big part in making like the melody for it, yeah? Like you pretty much came up with it?
Yeah, we were working at Eduardo's studio one time and we were like sitting and thinking like, is this gonna make it? They're just like, let's keep working on this, you know? But let's do it all collective. Let's think about it. And we were like just throwing ideas right there sitting on the studio, just like, few weeks before we were going into the studio actually to track the whole album, and we were just like, you know, what about this, put this on the lyrics, how do you feel it? And Bardo was like really open and listening to what was going on the surroundings and creating right there on the spot just before the time was on, you know. So it was just like really natural, actually. It happens, everything. And for good, because sometimes when you go just for the simple things, you can reach a new level. Because with the help of Leon and Sean just mixing, Leon was playing all the percussion. He elevates all the whole masa, you know. He put everything up, you know, on the studio.
One thing that I think you find interesting is in the beginning of writing this whole record, I know Carlos had been pushing for this record, Carlos was pushing for trying new things, trying different things than we've always done. And that was great. But he was up against a big mountain, you know. But his push was like, why don't we all just get in a room and write together? Why don't we try that as a process? And so we tried it, maybe for like 1 or 2 weeks. And then after a while, it just wasn't working because, like Bardo was alluding to earlier, like inspiration just doesn't come from being in a room with, you know, four walls and like, you know, no air. Maybe it comes with hanging out with your fam, being at the beach. So it just comes like a ray, you know, and then you have some idea. So then we ditched kind of that idea after a while so that we can all gather our strength, work in teams, you know, and then come in with something more produced and together. And it's funny that this was the very last song that we worked on. And the only thing we had was the bass line, the beat, and then the guitar, just like 13 minutes of that, you know? So then at the final hour, we went to my studio and it's the four of us in a room, spontaneously needing to create like this song that day, then and there. So it was like that process that we had ditched from the very beginning. We had to do it on the final day. And it's like,
full circle.
It's like laying down on the floor of the studio control room, Gabo getting a percussion. Everybody's going like, you know, mumbling, like saying words. Bardo's like, Bella, Bella. And just Bardo will go off, you get a piece of paper. And then like, at one point I think Bardo's just like, okay, I'm gonna go. Like I got something, like I'm gonna go, you know? And that's basically how Bardo is like, we had a session with Caloncho a year ago or something, and then just like we're in a session and just has to go outside and go get some air or something. Or we did we're doing a track over in Venice, the stuff that has been unreleased, and he went to the beach. We're all tracking like serious, like with his top producer, and he's like, all right, I'm gonna go to the beach, man, I'll see you guys in a little bit. So Gabo and I were tracking the drums. And he went to the beach, got in the water, came back, and he just, you know, got to work with what needed to get done. And it's just like, that's the way inspiration works. But for this particular instance, it was the four of us in a room being like, let's make it happen right now. That's never happened. And I think that's the power of limitations is endless.
Yeah, interesting concept for sure. I mean, and you hear those stories all the time, like, oh, we had to write this, like these last three songs or whatever in the studio, and then they became like these great songs. So that, I love that that's what happened here with Bella. And we've got one more song, final song on the album, Wounds. This one is like a good reflection on saying goodbye. And I think it wraps it up nicely. It's just like a good final piece to this collection of songs. Tell me a little bit more about recording this one. I mean, we talked about being in Barefoot Studios, using Stevie Wonder's piano on it. Like, yeah. What other like tidbits about Wounds can we go into?
Yeah, that was a song that I brought in to Gabriel and Eduardo. I had worked on it in my home studio, and a lot of the vibe was already there. I just needed the rhythm section. And when we decided to track it, like they were talking about, there was like Leon's list, like his list of his preference of all our, we had like 20 songs we demoed. So there was 20 songs up for grabs for this 12 song record. And he had his list. And I remember like Wounds was like at the bottom of his list. And I was like, all right, that's not going to make it, you know? And I think Eduardo pushed Leon to, hey, we got to record this song. Like, everyone in the band likes this song. Maybe you don't like it, but we like this song. So let's record this song on the last day. So it's the last song of the record, and it's the last song we recorded. And it's meaningful in that Eduardo's, he looks like he lost signal, but his cousin passed away during that week that we were making this record. He had literally just come from dealing with like arrangements for his, you know, his family member. And he came straight into the studio, and we're tracking this song about death and loss of people you love or care about. And Leon, it was his idea to like, we needed like an intro. And so Leon just brought that L. Michaels Affair, like swagger to the intro track. It sounds like straight up L. Michaels Affair, and I love it. And he just got down on Stevie Wonder's piano and started working out, like rearranging some of the harmonic content of the guitar part, and it just sounded beautiful. And that was it. And Bardo jumped on the guitar, was playing some guitar on it as well. And it was there. It was just there. And when we heard the final vocals, I remember just being floored. I thought Bardo did an amazing job of capturing that emotion. And I can feel it when I hear him sing that song. And I remember just loving it and being like, this is a great song. I know our fans are going to love this song. And we had, you know, we were discussing the track list because I think we recorded 14 songs, only 12 songs are on the record. And that was, Wounds was like one of the ones that like wasn't a favorite with anybody except the band. Like everyone outside of our circle was like, I don't really like that one. I'm like, I'm telling you, people are going to cry when they sing this song at our shows. Like, I know our fans. And yeah, I've seen that kind of reaction online. People say all the time, this song makes me cry when I read the lyrics and I listen to it for the first time.
Well, and also
because Latinos are emo, they need that one song to cry to. Latinos are emo, they need that one song to cry to. That's our song. This song used to be called Bach because of the classical nature. Carlos is like classical nature of the composition.
And, it's like counterpoint. Counterpoint happening in it, so it's like very like classical sounding. I was like, this is too weird. I don't know. Like I said, maybe I'm the most closed-minded because I was like, Chicano Batman won't mess with this. This is like for me, I guess. But no, like I said, nothing's off the table for me for now and forever. I won't think that way because the band has proven once again that throw anything at any one of us and we can make something out of it.
My bass line is so like nasty. Like every time we're rehearsing it, I could see Carlos laughing at me because the line moves like in like one fret intervals. I'm playing like this. And it's just not something I'm used to doing with my fingers. And it's like, take a look. Try to play. It's so simple, but it's like your brain doesn't work that way, you know? So that's why
I hated that song.
And I also like this anecdote of like the photographer came in during the track, like the end of this song or whatever, and he was like, "Oh, this sounds like L. Michael's Affair," and you're like, "Yeah, he's like right there, like producing yeah. with us." Like, but that also brings in like the photography part of this album, like the artwork for it is super gorgeous. Where did you find the photographer to work on this one?
Craigslist.
Nice.
Liar.
No, totally not. Carlos, take it away, bro.
Check it out.
Yeah, check it out.
Rala Choi.
So Carlos, his name is Rala Choi. Yeah, his name is Rala Choi. He's a South Korean artist that I found just on, we get little tasks every now and then from our management. All right, guys, you guys got to find some artists you want to work with for a t-shirt design or the album art. Now's a good time to start entertaining people and checking out what's out there. So things are relatively democratic. So we all go and find, go do our homework. And I don't know, I came back with him with some stuff I found of his and I just loved it. I felt it was like the vibe. And our management reached out to his management, and due to the language barrier and obviously we're going across borders here to find an artist, whereas normally we'd go to someone like in LA or whatever. We didn't hear from him or his team for like weeks, and our management was kind of like, "All right, guys, it's time to move on. This is not going to happen. Like, we got to go to a plan B." And I was like, "I'm not giving up. Like, I believe in this." And I remember we were in Marfa, and we were playing the, what was it, Cosmico Festival, you guys, I think. And I just reached out to him on Instagram. I went to Google Translate, and I wrote him a whole paragraph in English and translated to Korean, sent it to him, and he wrote me back, like, immediately. And he was like, "Wow, this is awesome. Thank you so much for thinking of me. I'll check out your music." And then, like, a day went by, and he was like, "I love your guys' music. Like, it's amazing." And I was like, "All right, I'll send you our new album." And I sent him the new album, and he was like, "I love this. I want to do this. Let's make this happen." Before we knew it, like 2.5 weeks later, he's being flown out from Korea to LA, and we're in South LA on a soundstage filming the shooting the album cover. And it's actually photography, it's not painting. And so that's what I loved about his aesthetic, is that it looks like some Magritte or Hopper kind of style. Mm-hmm. And it's he just does so much with just like the aperture and the right set conditions. And he uses very minimal like processing digitally afterwards. So I like that regard. It kind of reminded me of how Chicano Batman works. Like, we don't use a lot of like manipulation too much in terms of like computers to create our actual instrumentation. Like, we're old school in the regard that we use like actual physical keyboards that are old, and you touch the instrument. You don't look at it on the screen and click a mouse, which is also an art form of itself, which I deeply respect. So there was like that kindred spirit again. And yeah, we were floored. He had a whole amazing creative plan for how he interpreted the artwork, and we just let him do his thing. We got out of his way. And so the whole point of it, what I'm trying to say, is we wanted to make an album cover that just lived as art within itself. That might not even be, that could be live independently of what was in the music. But they were just like I was saying on an interview earlier, you look like at a Miles Davis album, and it's just amazing art. And you just look at it when you're listening to it, and it just makes you think like, what does this make me feel? And that was the idea for this, was like, this could just live like in a art, like in a gallery somewhere as a piece by itself. And yeah, that was the goal from my point of view.
Awesome. Well, that wraps it up. That's the end of the album. So, I mean, this went much longer than I expected, but I really appreciate you guys taking the time to like go song by song on this awesome new album. Invisible People is out now. My guests are Chicano Batman. I am Bruce Trujillo for Indie 102.3. Thanks, guys.
Thanks, Bruce.
Thank you so much, Bruce.
As always. Thanks, guys.